instrumental of Come Just As You Are. One, two, three.
Guys, good morning and peace and grace to you on this day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. A special welcome to families that are here for our vacation Bible school review this morning. It's going to be a lot of fun. In a little bit, we're going to hear the kids sing a little bit of what they sang over vacation Bible school, which was amazing. We just had such a great time, not only with the VBS kids. There was like 25 or 30 of them. I lost count. And then there was a whole group of youth group kids that were here for the afternoons. And we did our mini mission to Monterey. We made went to the Good Samaritan Center, and we made 114, we made boxes for 114 families, boxes of food. So that was pretty awesome. Made blankets for Nancy's project and sandwiches for IHELP, and we did a beach cleanup. We had a competition at the beach, who could find the most interesting thing on their cleanup. So far, the winner, we're going to vote next youth group, was a full string of working Christmas lights that were just left on the beach. So we're going to use those to decorate the youth room. So we had that. Two announcements for the morning. Cross-generational Sunday school is going to be happening just after just between the worship services. And then after the second service is our congregational meeting. We're going to be electing members to our associate pastor nominating committee. It's particularly an exciting morning for me. So if you want to come back for that and help us talk about that, that would be awesome. And I also think we have a moment from ministry for Stephen Ministry.
Morning, everybody. Life is full of challenges today, whether a result of the world situation or personal challenges, loss of a loved one, illness, broken relationships, and the list goes on and on. But as Christians, we know that God will never leave us or forsake us, and we never need suffer alone. We have 15 Stephen ministers in our church who have received 50 hours of training and who are matched with one care receiver of the same gender. They come alongside you as you struggle with faith or life's challenges, whatever they may be, and they are conduits of God's grace and compassion, and their service is completely confidential. So if you or anyone you know is struggling or in need of loving care, please consider contacting Stephen Ministry. You can call Pastor Mark, or you can call Sandy Larson, who is our referrals coordinator. Thank you.
Good morning. Would you please stand with us as we sing? I think what she said was very important, that we all are coming with all of our stuff, right? And so God just says, come as you are. So we're going to sing about that this morning.
Thank you.
gates and come just as you are.
Come just as you are. And hear the Spirit call. And come just as you are.
Come and see. Come just as you are.
Come just as you are. Hear the Spirit call. Come just as you are.
Come receive
Christ the King.
Jesus calls us to enter the joy of discipleship, the joy of following in that way. But our brokenness clings to us closely, and we struggle to respond fully to Christ's invitation. So we come to seek forgiveness. We come to seek wholeness. We confess together in unison, not because we are feeling guilt-ridden, not out of some act of self-righteous piety, but just simply out of the recognition that we can be better today than we were yesterday and still better tomorrow than we are today. So I invite you, if you are comfortable, to join with us in the prayer of confession that you'll see on the screen. Let us confess. God of perfect love, you continually bring forth life, transforming sadness to joy, despair to hope. We are weak, but you are strong. Our ways are flawed, but your ways are true. We are seldom right, but you are never wrong. Forgive us, redeem us, transform us. Take away the sin that burdens us, and restore us to the people you would have us be. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior, amen. And in the silence now, I invite you to be with God on your own terms for a few moments. Together the people say, amen. Relentlessly, God seeks us out. With abundant grace and boundless mercy, God is seeking us out. And this is the good news, that in Jesus Christ, we are already forgiven. Amen. May the peace of Christ be with you. I invite you to share that peace with those closest to you in the pews. I invite you to have a seat now, unless you're a kid, and then I think Miss Jade down here would like to have a word with you. We've got a little something cooked up for the congregation with the kids this morning.
Oh. Is this working? Yeah, all right. Kiddos, if you could come up and join me up here. All right. Good morning, everyone. That's wonderful. All right. We learned a lot at Vacation Bible School this week, didn't we? Yeah. Did we learn a lot this week? Yes. And one thing we learned is to sing the song that helps us know the Lord's Prayer. And we thought it would be a good idea to teach it to all the grown-ups, right? Yes. Okay, everyone come on up because we know we're going to dance around and we want to be on nice solid ground up here. So come on up. So this is, thank you.
All the food that the kids collected this week to go to local food ministries. So they did a great job.
All right. Okay, so this song is a call and response kind of song. So we are going to teach it to you that way. So I'll lead and the kids will follow at the beginning, and then they will lead and you all will follow. And I believe the words are up on the screen already so you can see them. And if you can do the hand motions too, we'd love for you to join in with that. If you feel like you want to stand up, stand up. It'll be great fun. All right, are you ready? Yeah. All right, let's do this. Let's raise the volume back there. Yeah. Can we start it over and raise the volume, Theo? Thank you so much. Our Father in heaven, how awesome is your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive our sins as we forgive. Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom forever and ever, and yours is the power forever, amen. Yours is the glory forever and ever, forever and ever and ever, amen. God. Our Father in heaven, our Father, how awesome is your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive our sins as we forgive. Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom forever and ever, and yours is the power forever, amen. Yours is the glory forever and ever, forever and ever, amen. You taught us to pray. Jesus, you taught us to pray. You taught us to pray. Jesus, you taught us to pray. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive our sins as we forgive. Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom forever and ever, and yours is the power forever, amen. Yours is the glory forever and ever, forever and ever and ever, amen. Forever and ever and ever, amen. Forever and ever and ever, amen.
Yay! Good job, guys! Really good! Yay! All right, friends, you can go join your parents or whoever you came with this morning.
There you go.
All right, good morning. Please join me in the prayer for illumination. Gracious God, illumine these words by your Spirit that we might hear what you would have us hear and be who you would have us be. For the sake of Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh. Amen. Now from Colossians 2, 6 through 15 and 16 through 19. As you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, continue to live your lives in him, rooted and built up in him and established in the faith, just as you were taught, abounding in thanksgiving. See to it that no one takes you captive through philosophy and empty deceit, according to human tradition, according to the elemental spirits of the universe, and not according to Christ. For in him the whole fullness of deity dwells bodily, and you have come to fullness in him, who is the head of every ruler and authority. In him also you were circumcised with a special circumcision by putting off the body of the flesh in the circumcision of Christ when you were buried with him in baptism. You were also raised with him through faith in the power of God who raised him from the dead. And when you were dead in trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive together with him when he forgave us all our trespasses, erasing the record that stood against us with its legal demands. He set this aside, nailing it to the cross. He disarmed the rulers and authorities and made a public example of them, triumphing over them in it. Therefore, do not let anyone condemn you in matters of food and drink, or of observing festivals, new moons, or Sabbaths. These are only a shadow of what is to come, but the substance belongs to Christ. Do not let anyone disqualify you, insisting on self-abasement and worship of angels, dwelling on visions, puffed up without cause by a human way of thinking, and not holding fast to the head, from whom the whole body, nourished and held together by its ligaments and sinews, grows with the growth that is from God. Holy wisdom, holy words. Thanks be to God.
Please stand again with us as you are comfortable, as we sing a couple of songs. And as I get my music straightened out. Sing worthy. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Sing, I will build. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken, and I will build my life upon
beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. For my waking breath, for my daily bread, I depend on you. I depend on you for the sun to rise, for my sleep at night. I depend on you. I depend on you. You're the way, the truth, and the life. You're the well that never runs dry. I'm the branch and you are the vine. Draw me close and teach me to abide.
Where the Spirit leads.
Where the Spirit leads. As I'm following, I depend on you. I depend on you for the victories still in front of me. I depend on you. I depend on you. You're the way, the truth, and the life. You're the well that never runs dry. I'm the branch and you are the vine. Draw me close and teach me to abide. Be my strength, my song in the night. Be my all, my treasure, my prize. I am yours forever, you're mine. Draw me close and teach me to abide. When I pass through death, as I enter rest, I depend on you. I depend on you for eternal life, to be raised with Christ. I depend on you. Jesus, I depend on you. You're the way, the truth, and the life. You're the well that never runs dry. I'm the branch and you are the vine. Draw me close and teach me to abide. Be my strength, my song in the night. Be my my all, my treasure, my prize. I am yours forever, you're mine. Draw me close and teach me to abide. You're the way, the truth, the life. Teach me, Lord, to abide. I'm the branch, you're the vine. Teach me, Lord, to abide. You're the way, the truth, the life. Teach me, Lord, to abide. I'm the branch, you're the vine. Teach me, Lord, to abide.
Thanks, guys. Please be seated. The second reading this morning comes from Luke chapter 1, I think. Luke chapter 11, verses 1 through 13. Let us listen together for holy wisdom. Now he, Jesus, was praying in a certain place. And after he had finished, one of his disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray as John taught his disciples." And Jesus said to them, "When you pray, say, 'Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone indebted to us. And do not bring us to the time of trial.'" And Jesus said to them, "Suppose one of you has a friend, and you go to him at midnight, and you say to him, 'Friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread. For a friend of mine has arrived, and I have nothing to set before him.' And your friend answers from within, 'Don't bother me. The door's already locked, and my children are in bed. I can't get up and give you anything.' I tell you, even though your friend will not give you anything because he is his friend, at least because of his persistence, he will get up and give him whatever he needs. So I say to you, ask. It will be given to you. Search, you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened for you. For everyone who asks receives, and everyone who searches finds. For everyone who knocks, the door will be opened. Is there anyone among you who, if your child asks for a fish, will give it a snake instead of a fish?" That might actually happen in my house. "Or if the child asks for an egg, will give a scorpion? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him?" Holy wisdom, holy words, thanks be to God. I grew up in Reading, Pennsylvania, about as far from here as you can get, almost. My pastor growing up there in Pennsylvania was a man named George Goodrich. He was a great pastor. I still know him. He's an amazing pastor. How do I know? Because I still remember the things that he said. I still remember the stories he told the week that my mother died, the week that my father died, 40 years after being in youth group with him. He called me just to make sure things were okay, to tell me how amazing my parents had been in the church and how much he loved them and how he was praying for me. I was just a teenager in that youth group, and I still remember the things that he said to me. They affected my life. One day in youth group, we were talking about prayer and what that meant and how to do it. And he recalled how when he was in college, he was taking an exam. And the exam was hard, and he was stumped, and he didn't know what to do, and he didn't know the answer. And he was just sitting there, head bowed and his head in his hands, as he tried to parse out the answer, sitting like this. Now, the professor, knowing that George was a religious person and not being a religious person himself, decided to have a little fun. And he said, "Goodrich, I don't think prayer is going to help you now." Well, Pastor George thought to himself, he said to us, "I hadn't actually been praying at that point. I was just frustrated and trying to figure out what was going to come next. But I thought to myself, why not? It can't hurt to pray, so I did. Not for an answer, really, but for calmness, for an end to my anxiety. And you know, I don't know, George said, if it was a miracle or if it was just the descent into the practice of my old friend prayer, but it worked. I calmed down. I was able to think more clearly. I didn't ace the test, but I did pass. And he was the first person I ever heard use that phrase that we joke with now. He says, as long as there are exams in school, there will be prayers in school as well. And I think that's right. He was the first person to say that. I don't know if he coined it. I've heard that a million times since. I get asked about prayer a lot, and I think about what George said, what Pastor George said. People are curious, and they ask pastors about prayer, and so we come back to it again and again. They want to know what prayer is. How does prayer actually work? Does it work at all? And if you want to make a room get very quiet and very quickly, just look around and say, would anyone like to lead us in prayer? And suddenly the room gets as silent as a middle school classroom right after the teacher has asked for a volunteer. Everyone's just sort of looking down, hoping that you won't see them. And it was really no different in Jesus' time. Take that bit of scripture that I just read. The disciples of Jesus, they've been hanging out with him for a little bit, and they know that other teachers are teaching their students, and they are curious about what Jesus will say prayer is and how prayer is done. They basically ask the same question that we ask. How does it work? How do we do it? How do we make prayer effective? And the truth is, and I think if anyone is honest when they answer this question, they will say, that answer is elusive. I know for me, the answer to how prayer works and does it actually work has been an elusive one over the course of my life. Early on, I was taught, like most of us, to go to God with what I needed. We're all taught that, right? To give thanks at mealtimes before we eat food, to pray before we go to sleep, to ask God for help for folks in trouble, for folks who are sick. And I suppose that makes sense, but the problem is it just doesn't always seem to work, doesn't it? How often are we going to have to pray after some horrible national event for something to change, and we just don't see a change? I can't tell you how many times I've sat in a hospital next to someone, prayed for their healing, and they haven't been cured. They don't come home from the hospital. I think anyone who's honest will say that the prayer is not easy. The answers about prayer are not easy prayers. If you ask someone about prayer and they give you a bumper sticker answer, it's probably not really going to be satisfying. And I hate to do this, but there are some things that I know prayer isn't, and maybe that is a good place to start. I know for sure that prayer isn't magic. I'm not exactly sure how it always works, but I know it's not magic. It's not an incantation. It doesn't work better if you say your prayers in Latin like Harry Potter, or if you're carrying a wand. That is not what prayer is. If that were the case, God would be little more than a caseworker bound to our whims. And prayer is not a good luck charm. I know that. Often we think of prayer and God like a good luck charm, a rabbit's foot to be rubbed, a genie in a bottle to be called when we have a wish we'd like granted. And that seems far from what a God who created the entire universe would be. It seems like a waste of the power of the universe to imagine that prayers are something as simple as a child's wish on a Christmas Eve, hoping you get that bike or that puppy. And again, God would be little more than a caseworker bound to our whims if that were the case. God would be very small. I've had opportunity to preach on this bit of scripture a few times. In the 12 years that I've been here, this passage about prayer that includes the Lord's Prayer has come up on our Sunday morning readings 3 times. And each time we try to think a little bit about what prayer actually is. This is a prayer that if you say it, if you say it out loud, it takes somewhere between 15 and 30 seconds, depending on how quickly you go. And this is the way Jesus taught us to pray. The words are simple words. The concepts are simple concepts. It's not poetry. You wouldn't think that Shakespeare wrote this or even a pulp fiction writer. It acknowledges God. It makes simple requests. It gives thanks, not much more. And this is the model that Jesus commends to us. We think things that have to be fancy, and that's why we shy away when the pastor says, "Who would like to pray now?" We think it has to be fancy. But the truth is sometimes simple is best. And so it seems to be with prayer if we're to take this admonition from Jesus seriously. It doesn't have to be fancy, poetic words. It has to be simple. It can be simple. It can be easy. The last time I preached this passage, I was thinking about the simplicity of this prayer of Jesus. I mean, we get all twisted up about prayer, and we think it has to be elegant, and it has to be involved, and maybe you have to have a degree in something in order to say a really effective, beautiful prayer. We think we can't do it because we're not sure that we have words that are beautiful enough words or sentiments that are deep enough to get the job done. But look at this prayer that Jesus gave us. It's not fancy. It's only as fancy as the pirouette that the kids did up here a minute ago. And I read through this instruction from Jesus this time, though, and what I notice is what at first seems a little bit of a tension between do a lot of things and don't do much at all. In the first part of the reading, Jesus says, keep it simple, keep it short. But in the second part of the reading, Jesus says, keep praying, right? Like any noise you make, if you make it often enough, someone's going to do something about it. Just a second ago, I went out to grab a cup of coffee to wake up a little bit. And hopefully the sermon's not putting you too much to sleep. There is coffee out there afterwards. And as I stood there, I heard a car horn starting to go off. And I turned around to come back in. And then I was like, do I have enough time to go over there and check out and see whose car alarm is going off? And I actually made it all the way through the fellowship hall and over to the edge of the parking lot before it went off. Because the horn kept going off, it broke my attention from what I was supposed to be doing here. And I went over to make sure that things were okay. If you make enough noise and you make it often enough, you're going to get some attention. Keep praying. It's kind of a funny moment, really, in Scripture. Even if your friend won't give you what you ask because you're friends, he'll give it to you because you don't stop asking, right? It's like my kids when they want more ice cream or when they want to play a video game and I haven't yet given permission, and they keep asking, right? So what I get from this is that, yes, prayer should be a simple thing, but it should also be a regular thing. No matter how it works, it can't work if you're not doing it at all. So keep it simple and keep doing it. The more we pray, the more we understand prayer, the more we enter into a conversation with God, the more our will is aligned with God's will, and therefore the nature of our conversation with God and the nature of our asking becomes more mature, more nuanced, more realistic, less about wish fulfillment or lucky charms, less about magic, and more about knowing and being known by the Almighty, the Divine. And the interesting thing is, the most mature Christians I know, the ones who have been praying the longest, actually say the least when they are praying, and they listen more. Jesus says, knock, and the door will be opened. What does that look like? The first time I preached this passage was the second time that I ever preached here in this congregation. It was shortly after I had just arrived, and I told one of my favorite stories, which means I can't remember, but I'm guessing I've probably told it a bunch of times already, and you've heard it. But I'm following in the footsteps of Jay Bartow, so I figure I can repeat myself. I told the story of Brennan Manning, who is this amazing speaker that I heard many times in the 1990s. And he told the story once of how at a conference a woman approached him afterwards, and most folks wanted to ask questions, wanted to get clarification. Maybe they wanted a picture or an autograph from the famous speaker. But what she said really caused him to stop and to pay attention. She told him about her father, who was very sick. He'd been in the hospital battling cancer. And ultimately, she asked him for a favor. She said, would you come and pray with my dad? He really needs someone to pray with him. Well, Brennan responded, don't you have a pastor? Don't you have a priest who would come? Well, yes, she replied, but there's so much going on now, and there are other crises. She hasn't been able to get there to be with my dad recently, and wouldn't you just come with me just for a moment and just pray with him? So Brennan got his coat and left the conference and the line of people and followed her and went to the hospital. He walked into the room and he saw this older gentleman on a bed, and it looked like he was all ready for a visitor. A chair, a comfy chair, was pulled up next to the bed like he was expecting Brennan. And Brennan said, "Hey, I'm Brennan. Your daughter asked me to come and to pray with you. Looks like you're expecting me." "I'm expecting you? Well, I see the chair sitting there. You're expecting someone, right?" "Oh, the chair. I'll tell you about the chair if you promise not to tell my daughters. They'll think I'm crazy." So Brennan pulled up another chair and sat down. And the gentleman sitting there said, "You know, from the time I was little, I went to church and I wondered about prayer and I wondered if God could hear me. And I tried to pray. When I was a kid, I prayed by my bed and at the dinner table. But as I got older, that didn't seem to be quite right. And I saw prayers go unanswered. And I didn't really know that much about prayer. I went to my pastor when I was about 20 and I said, 'Hey, can you tell me about prayer?' And it was a new pastor, and he was just out of seminary, and he had a PhD in theology, and he reached back over his shoulder to his bookshelf, and he handed me this book that was this thick, and he said, 'Hey, this is the most recent book on the work of God and the power of prayer. If you read this, I think you'll do well.' So I got the book, and I opened it up, and I was reading it, and every other word was German or Latin, and I ended up looking through the dictionary most of the time, and I got so frustrated with it, I never even finished the book. And I just gave it back to him, and I went about my life, and for a long time, I just didn't really pray at all because I didn't understand that prayer. It couldn't be as complicated as that book. It couldn't be as simple as just making a wish. Then years later, I was talking to a friend, a new guy at church that we had gotten close to, and I asked him about prayer. And I said, 'How do you pray?' And he said, 'Well, for me, I think about it less about I'm asking God for something or I need something, and I think about it more as a conversation. I talk and I listen. So what I do is every morning when I get my cup of coffee, I sit down at the breakfast table in our little dinette, and I pull another chair up on the other side, and I just sit there, and I just start talking about everything in my life. And I imagine that Jesus is sitting in that chair as I talk. And sometimes I'm quiet, and the Spirit moves, and my conscience is tweaked, and I hear something, but oftentimes it's just silence. Sometimes I'm yelling, because that's what you do when you have a good friend who's listening to you. Sometimes I'm crying, because when good friends listen, you can have that emotion. That's what I do. I pull up a chair, and I imagine that Jesus is sitting across the table from me." The man sat up a little bit in his hospital bed and says, "So that's what I've been doing. For 15 years, that's how I've been praying. I pull a chair up wherever I am, whenever I need to pray, and I imagine that Jesus is sitting there in that chair, and that's why that chair is here in the hospital. That's where I imagine Jesus is sitting. I don't know. You're the pastor. You've been to school. You tell me, is that prayer?" And Brennan said, "That sounds more like prayer than just about anything I've ever heard." And so he went home. They prayed together, and Brennan anointed him with oil, and Brennan went home. And then a couple weeks later, the woman called and to express her thanks, to say, "Thanks for praying with my dad. It meant so much to him. He was so calm. It was just a really great moment." "Well, I'm glad I could have been there. How is your dad?" "Well, you know, he passed away over the weekend." "How was the passing? Was it a good death?" And she said, "It was, but it was the strangest thing. When we came into the room, he was on his knees with his head in the seat of an empty chair." I think that is what knocking looks like. I think that is what an answer looks like. He was not cured, but he was healed. And his final moment was in the presence of Jesus. Knock, and the door will be opened. Ask, and an answer will be given. Know that Jesus is in the room with you, ready to take any chair that you pull up. Amen. I want to invite you to a moment of generosity. We don't pass the plates here in the service. There is a plate in the back. If you have something to give on your way out and it's a good morning for you to give, that would be awesome. If you're with us online this morning, and I know that some of you already are, you can go to our homepage, fpcmonterey.org, and there's a button to click on to give that way. But what I always remind us is that God doesn't want your stuff. God doesn't need our money. So it's not a good morning to give. Don't give. There will be a morning when it will be a good morning to give. What God wants most is just your heart. And when your heart is in the right place, everything else will follow as it should. And if you are giving, realize that that is our amen. That is us saying yes together to the ministries that God has called us to, from having just more kids than I could count for a week, do all kinds of amazing things, to taking food to food banks, to housing the homeless. Our giving is the yes to those ministries that God has called us to. Now, would you pray with me? Gracious Lord, we don't understand how prayer works. We don't always see the things that we hope for happen. But in our best moments as we pray, we feel you with us. In our best moments as we pray together as a community, we feel you in the spaces between us. Help us to keep feeling that. And maybe, Lord, help us to learn how to be the answer to those prayers for each other. You have shown us, Lord, how we should be, what we should do. Help us to do those things and to be those ways. And I have a feeling, God, if we do that, most of our prayers will find answers. We pray today for folks we love who can't be here, folks who are far away, folks who are maybe not feeling well this morning. We pray, Lord, that they will experience your healing. Show us, Lord, how to be there for them in their discomfort. We pray for our servicemen and women around the globe, wherever they are worshiping this morning, especially here in Monterey. We pray for the DLI and for MPS and students who are far away from their families this morning, that they might find peace and comfort and community. We pray for our world, Lord. There is so much going on that needs healing. There's so much brokenness that needs to be made whole. Step into those places, Lord, and teach us how to step with you. We give thanks, Lord, for our congregation and the things that they are doing. We give you thanks for a successful VBS. We give thanks for a successful youth mini mission to Monterey. We give thanks for a group of faithful people marching in the Pride Parade yesterday. And I give you thanks for the people who shook my hand and thanked us for being there as a church representing your inclusive love. Lord, hear us now as we pray the prayer you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Please stand one more time with us as we sing and as you feel comfortable and led to. We're going to sing a song about waiting on the Lord. I mean, that's the prayer aspect, right? Sometimes we're waiting for a long, long, long time as we pray and continue to pray. But our God is amazing, everlasting, and we're going to sing about that this morning. The strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope,
our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. And you do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak, and you comfort those in need, and you lift us up on wings like eagles. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak, and you comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. Sing our God. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. And you do not faint, you won't grow weary. Lord, teach us to defend the weak and to comfort those in need as you lift us up on wings like eagles. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. Lord, teach us to defend the weak and to comfort those in need as you lift us up on wings like eagles.
Not exactly sure how prayer works. I hope that's okay to admit. I do know, and I can tell you, over a lifetime of faith and in the church, that it does make a difference. I don't know how it works, but somehow it does. So I invite you to wait upon the Lord, to knock, understanding that God is in the room and waiting to have a seat just with you. And now, may the love of God and the grace of Jesus Christ and the companionship of the Holy Spirit be with us, and all those we love, and all those Jesus calls us to love, now and forevermore. Amen.